Okay, just by way of quick review, let me remind everyone this is an on-the-record session, single subject, that being the contract announcement of the airborne laser. We have several speakers to open the program, and then we'll have a number of our speakers, or actually our program experts, remain behind for some questions and answers. And with that, let me introduce our first speaker, the Undersecretary of the Air Force, the Honorable Rudy de Leon.
Thank you, and welcome to this announcement. November is going to be a very important month for the United States Air Force and also the aerospace industry. Last Friday, we announced the contract award on the space-based infrared satellite system. Today, we do the airborne laser, and next week, the Joint Strike Fighter. These programs are important because they'll frame the Air Force of the 21st century. I'm happy to announce the airborne laser because this is truly one program that will define the future of the Air Force. It is a revolutionary capability. It is a weapon that will operate at the speed of light. It is very precise. It is cutting-edge technology for warfighters, and it can destroy chemical or biological weapons over enemy territory. It will no doubt figure prominently in the upcoming quadrennial review. With us is Air Force Chief of Staff General Ron Fogleman, also Lieutenant General Les Lyles, who will talk about how this Air Force program fits into the overall DoD theater missile defense architecture, and then finally Harry Schulte, one of our program executive officers, who will give you airborne laser program details. So let me yield to General Fogleman for the announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you all for coming. Today, I think the nation and the United States Air Force takes a major step into the future with what we truly believe is a historic announcement of the winning contractor and their design for the airborne laser, or as it's referred to, the ABL. This is truly a revolutionary system. It's one that I think will enhance our nation's defenses against theater ballistic missiles, and at the same time increase our understanding of directed energy weapons. Whether we find ballistic missiles that are armed with conventional warheads or warheads of mass destruction, certainly ballistic missiles pose a threat around the world to U.S. forces. The proliferation of these weapons makes it very likely that we will again confront them in the future. With a military strategy that's sort of capsulized in Secretary Perry's three words of deter, defend, and defeat, we as a nation want to try and prevent the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, and it's crucial that we develop an effective capability to defend against them in the cases where the weapons are employed. Now, when you look at the problem of trying to defeat theater ballistic missiles, I think you have to look at it as an approach that epitomizes a system of systems thing. That is, you start out with an intelligence preparation of the battlefield, where you want to know, does this person have such weapons? Where are they stored? Where might they be deployed to be employed, et cetera? You have to have a command control battle management system that allows you to then implement in a layered fashion some sort of a counter against these systems. And certainly the first thing you want to do is try to destroy them on the ground if you can. We call that attack ops. That's the best place to attack them if you can. Second place is in the boost phase. If you can catch them at their most vulnerable, their pressurized vessel, illuminated as they climb out. If you can destroy them in that phase, then, of course, the missile falls back on the adversary's homeland, and that's an added deterrence, if you will. Once you get into the terminal phase, of course, you want to be able to protect your high-value assets, and so terminal phase becomes important. So as we look at this whole system of systems thing, we think we've made great strides in the attack option area since the end of the Gulf War. We also believe that once one of these missiles is launched, it becomes important that we be able to stop it, and as I say, a layered defense is always better than a single point. The ABL will complement the terminal defenses that are being developed and being fielded. The ABL is in many ways a classic Air Force program. That is, it's something that's on the leading edge of technology. It promises the way we think, to change the way we think about warfare. And we believe that the cost and the risk right now are manageable. The time is right for further development and for the fielding and display of this technology. The system truly has the promise of providing the nation with a rapidly deployable global capability of defending against theater ballistic missiles. When we pair the laser with a 747-400 aircraft that's air refuelable, it will allow the ABL to deploy worldwide rapidly. Once in a theater, it can be established in orbit, combat air patrol to protect the other arriving forces. Now, by attacking the missiles in the boost phase, we think this takes the fight to the enemy. And I've already described the fact that if you can knock a missile down while it's climbing out, whatever that missile's carrying rains on the other guy, not on your own troops. So we believe the ABL will give us the capability to intercept these missiles before they can deploy their submunitions, and this, in fact, will ease the burden that's placed on terminal defenses. As Secretary de Leon mentioned, the ABL is a vital part of the Air Force's future vision for assuring air and space superiority against a variety of threats. We think this superiority is going to be vital for military operations in the first quarter of the 21st century. In developing a revolutionary system, which we have recently named a prototype attack laser, or the YAL-1A, and taking the concept from the drawing board to rubber on the ramp requires initiative, innovation, and commitment. And so the Air Force today announces the award of the Airborne Laser Weapon System to the industry team that's led by the Boeing Company, teamed with TRW and Lockheed Martin. To that team, congratulations and good luck. I would now like to introduce the director of the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization, Lieutenant General Les Lyles, and he's going to give you a few more details on how this system fits within the overall architecture for defending against theater ballistic missiles. Les?
Thank you, gentlemen, General Fogleman, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First, I'd like to thank the Air Force for the opportunity to participate in this ceremony. This is obviously a very exciting day for the United States Air Force, a very exciting day for the Department of Defense. It's also an exciting time for the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization. As most of you know out there, we have received unprecedented support from Congress and administration to develop ballistic missile defense systems. These systems are forming the cornerstone of the nation's missile defense architecture as we attempt to defend our American and allied troops against a very, very real theater ballistic missile threat. Such systems as Patriot, PAC-3, THAAD, Navy Area Defense, and eventually Navy Upper Tier will be able to neutralize most threats against our soldiers, our sailors, and our airmen. However, when I look at the architecture, we have always had a missing link in it. And that missing link was the need for a boost phase intercept system. The airborne laser will fill that void. This boost phase intercept capability will give us a second layer of missile defense and actually add four layers for us. Attack operations, as General Fogelman described, boost phase intercept, which will be provided by the ABL, a third layer of defense, which is our mid-course system, such as the THAAD and Navy Upper Tier, and then a forced layer of terminal defenses such as Patriot, PAC-3, and Navy Area Defense. The bottom line objective, of course, is to minimize leakage of warheads through an integrated systems of systems capability. By attacking theater ballistic missiles early in the boost phase, we're literally telling the enemy there's a very real potential that your TBMs will fall back on your homeland. Our architecture, with the addition of boost phase intercept, is enhanced in several ways. First, we add a true weapon of deterrence. An aggressor will think twice before launching against our forces because of the potential that his capabilities could land back in his homeland. Second, the ABL will be able to defeat TBMs prior to the deployment of advanced penetration aids. And our intelligence forces tell us that these aids are predominantly used for delivering chemical and biological payloads. So it's very, very important that we attack them very early. Third, the ABL will ensure our mid-course and terminal defenses are not overwhelmed during a very large raid, a coordinated raid, by thinning out the incoming missiles. This will allow us to size our defenses appropriately to make sure we have enough to counter the threat. And fourth, by virtue of detecting TBMs very early in their stage, right after their launch, ABL will be able to provide more accurate launch and impact data to the Ballistic Missile Defense System network. The bottom line is we're going to enhance our terminal systems with this, enhance our passive defense, and even enhance attack operations. I hope you can see that BMDO, the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization, is just as excited about this capability as is the Air Force. It's going to greatly enhance our architecture, give us tremendous additional capabilities. And we look forward to working with the Air Force to ensure both its support and certainly its success. And speaking of architectures, I'd like now to introduce one of the architects of the acquisition strategy for the ABL, the Program Executive Officer for Weapons Programs, Mr. Harry Schulte.
Thanks, Les. Good afternoon. Three of the technologies that had to come together to make the airborne laser possible are shown on the three charts you see on your left and on my right. Basically, we had to reach the point where you could have a compact, high-energy laser that was efficient. You had to be able to actively track a boosting missile using, in this case, an illuminating laser to do that. And also, you had to figure out how do you compensate for the turbulence in the atmosphere. How do you propagate a laser wave through the atmosphere? These three key technologies have come together now and allowed us to think about putting a system like this in the air. Let me go to the first chart. I'm going to give you some general overview information on the program. I've got some smart guys over here who's going to help me answer any questions, and I'll moderate that when I finish here. The concept of ops is that we figure you're going to have bad weather. So just assume you're going to have bad weather, and you're going to have clouds to about 39,000 feet. Your airplane, in this case, a 747-400 freighter modified for the airborne laser mission, will be flying at around 40 to 42,000 feet. First time it gets a chance to see the boosting missile is probably at about 39,000 feet. It's got IR sensors on it so that it can autonomously find the missile. You've got about, depending on the kind of threat missile we're talking about here, you got anywhere from 40 to 100 seconds to shoot it down. So you've got to acquire the missile, you've got to track the missile, and then you've got to fire the laser, put an energy on for, let's say, a nominal 5 seconds to shoot it down, and then you go find another target in the case of a salvo type of mission. So this is what we're looking at. Seeing the missile when it gets above the cloud deck, maybe around 39,000 feet, you find it, you track it, and you shoot it with the laser, and you move on to another target. Let me go to the next chart. Now, talking about this overall program, General Fogleman said a $1.1 billion award today to the Boeing-led team. Basically, we're talking about this part phase of the program is in green here. The program definition risk reduction phase, we've broken into two phases here, but basically the $1.1 billion contract covers that entire green area. We're coming out of a concept design contracts that both teams had, about $22 million contracts for about 2 years now. We've just awarded this contract for PDR phase one and phase two, 77 months in which we'll do the initial design and then the detailed design, do fabrication and integration on the aircraft itself, and then culminate in a graduation exercise, so to speak, of shooting down a boosting ballistic missile. Look to do that probably in late 02 timeframe. Assuming that's successful on this lethal intercept demo, we'll go into EMD program and then go into production. We're looking at a total of 7 aircraft. One aircraft you will buy now in PDRR. One aircraft we'll buy in EMD. 5 aircraft will be bought in production, and then the first 2 will be refurbed to become part of the production fleet. So there's no aircraft lost in this process. We're looking at a 3 aircraft IOC in the 06 time frame, and a full operational capability of 7 aircraft in about the 08 time frame. Next chart, please. Let me just talk about some of the members of the Boeing team. Basically, the leader of the team is the Boeing Defense and Space Group in Seattle. Not only are they program integrators and lead, but also they're in charge of the ballistic missile C4I tasks that are part of ABL. The major subcontractors are Lockheed Martin, who are in charge of beam control for this team, and TRW, also in California, who have the high energy laser and also the illuminating laser. You'll see the Airborne Laser Program Office is at Kirtland Air Force Base. They work for the Space and Missile Center out of Los Angeles. And that's a small team, about 50 folks that are out at Kirtland. Other companies that you see on here are subcontractors that provide various systems for the aircraft. For instance, General Electric, the engines on this 747 will be GE engines. And the modification to the aircraft will be done at the Boeing facility in Wichita. And there are a few other contractors on there also. So what I'd like to do now is introduce some folks that are going to help me. I'll moderate, and they'll help me answer questions. Lieutenant General Lyles, you have met from BIMDO. Major General Speedy Martin, from Director of Operational Requirements here in the Pentagon. Major General John Hawley, who's Director of Requirements at Air Combat Command. And then Colonel Dick Tebay, who's a Program Director for ABL out of Kirtland. Yes, ma'am.
Can you say what it was about the Boeing proposal that made you opt in that direction?
Okay, let me try that. The strength of the Boeing team was in their laser, which basically is a TRW laser. They've been able to demonstrate already a laser module that meets the requirements for the system. It's not flight weighted yet, but it has produced the power. And they've also been able to show that they can reach the chemical efficiencies necessary to produce a laser in a coil laser. So they've made some great strides in that. A couple of other of their strengths, they were very strong in the ballistic missile C4I area. They had a very strong proposal on how they would integrate the communications suite on the aircraft with the overall architecture of the BMC4I, and they were very strong in their logistics area also on how this aircraft would be supported. I think maybe that touches it, maybe the top two or three. Yeah.
Schulte, the cost of total program costs, including EMD, production of 7 aircraft, and logistics tail.
Logistics tail, including, let me give it to you in pieces, and maybe I can build up to that. I think it's, as I recall, it's about $5 billion total. If you include the concept design phase, we've just gone through the PDRR, EMD, and the production phase. It's 4.8 to 5, as I recall. We've done some lifecycle cost analysis that would say that over, I think it was a 20-year, wasn't it, Dick? 20-year, it went.
Year ramp up, 20-year sustain.
Yeah, it was about another $6 billion, I think. So maybe the total life cycle cost of the entire system from day one on out was like $11 billion. Over half of that is the operational, just operating the system over a 20-year period of time. Does that answer your question? Okay. Yes, sir.
Do you have a rough red box estimate of how far the laser will be able to disable a rocket in its boost phase?
I would think maybe better than that. I think we have better than a bread box answer to this. But what I'm going to tell you may not seem better than that. It's in the hundreds of kilometers, depending on the target. Some targets are harder to hit than others. I say harder to hit. I should say harder to kill than others. Let me just, you opened up a question. Let me just talk about this. We didn't forget to clean the room. This is actually here as a prop. What we had done was got some data on what some enemy missiles are built of, how thick their casings are, and this was a demonstration that was done at Kirtland with scale type laser to show you the kind of kill mechanism that we expect this would have. You'll put a spot, because you can track the missile very accurately, you'll put a laser spot on a missile like this. Basically, you're going to heat it up, and it's going to rip like a sardine can. It basically has got a lot of pressure on the inside while it's boosting, so it's a very high pressure vessel, and then you basically it just peels right apart, and so there's a fair amount of data on what kind of energy you have to put onto the target, and we've got models that predict what kind of ranges. So depending on the target, I'm just going to leave it in the unclassified sense, it's hundreds of kilometers. It might be a little more for some kind of targets, maybe a little bit less for targets that are maybe a little bit harder to kill. Yes?
How long do you have to keep the laser spot on the target?
Colonel TB, why don't you answer that, please?
Mechanism is energy over time. It's just like putting your hand over a hot candle. If you move it through it quickly, it...
Why don't you come up here, Dick, so I can hear you, okay?
The kill mechanism requires energy over time. It's just like you sweep your hand quickly over a candle, won't bother you, but if you have to hold your hand there for a long period of time, pretty soon you're going to absorb enough energy where you pull it away. Nominally, we say about 5 seconds. The kill time can be less than that, and it can be slightly longer, but a nominal value is about 5 seconds.
Where would the planes be home base? Is there any thinking yet where that would be?
The answer is there's been some thinking, but it has not been determined where the home base will be. For testing purposes, we'll be testing out of Edwards Air Force Base. In fact, we're going to be using the B-2 facility that's soon to be vacated out at Edwards too, for the PDRR program and an EMD phase of the program, which, as we showed, is going to go for quite a while. It'll be tested out at Edwards, and ACC has yet to determine where they're going to base it. John, did you want to say anything more on that? Okay. Yeah.
Are they going to be new or refurbished 747s?
These are all new.
And that's obviously included in the... Yeah,
it's only it's a 7400-400 freighter. It's a basic, it's a commercial freighter that comes down the line. It'll be modified for the ABL. They're all new. Let me get one back here, Dylan.
What impact is Boeing's pending decision to purchase Rockwell Space and Defense business have on this decision?
Zero. In fact, to be honest with you, what Mrs. Drian, my boss in CFAQ, asked us to do is move up this source election by over 60 days, so it wouldn't have an effect on the source election. The problem is if when these mergers happen, sometimes you have to put up what we call these Chinese firewalls between pieces of the company so they don't talk to one another. So what we wanted to do was make sure that was not going to be a problem on this program. When this potential merger was first announced, we were thinking it might be approved as early as November. It looks like now if it gets approved, it might be in December. But what we tried to do is move the decision up ahead of that. So it made no difference. It was not a factor in the source selection, and it had nothing to do with the source selection. So basically, we took that variable out of it altogether. Let me get your question.
Is seven airplanes, is that a 2MRC fleet? Do you get one orbit with three airplanes? Do you get two orbits?
That sounds like a user answer to me here. Yeah.
The fleet has been sized as five aircraft, primary assigned aircraft, and two BAI aircraft. But it's envisioned that it will take three aircraft per orbit to sustain that orbit 24 hours a day. The aircraft will be able to remain on station up to about 18 hours. We'll carry an augmented crew to be able to do that. So yes, you can bring six airplanes fully up and still have one, say, in depot or something back in the States and be able to sustain two 24-hour orbits in two different MRCs.
Okay, so one...
But that's the minimum required.
One orbit would then be enough for a theater, is that the thinking?
That would be the thinking, or, we had to size it on something. Of course, if you don't have two different theaters, then you would have two orbits in a theater. But the worst case and the planning factor was a single orbit in two different theaters.
I also hear a cruise missile referred to occasionally in reference to airborne laser, too. Do you anticipate that as a growth capability? During
the PDRR phase, there will be studies done on the adjunct missions. But right now, the airborne laser is not being designed primarily against cruise missiles. It's being designed, as we've heard today, against the theater ballistic missile threat. But we will be looking at what kind of residual capabilities it'll have. In fact, we're going to look at four areas of what we call adjunct missions for the airborne laser. The first area being, of course, self-protection of the platform itself. The second area being protection of other high-value assets. The third one would be a cruise missile defense adjunct mission, if you will. And the fourth and final one would be just its contribution to airborne surveillance.
Colonel, what steers the laser toward its target? I mean, could you perceivably use this to hit a pressurized target on the ground? Or what steers it? How do you aim it?
As you saw in the earlier diagram, we pick up the boosting missile as it breaks through the cloud deck using a passive infrared sensor. It has a field regard of 360 degrees, so no matter which way the airplane is turning, you pick up the plume. We then fire a relatively low-energy tracking laser, an illuminator laser, to illuminate the hard body of the missile. If you look over at that picture on the right, we have transitioned from the plume to illuminate the hard body of the missile. And now we're tracking on the right, on that right-hand poster over there, on the hard body. And we're doing atmospheric compensation real-time, and we're lasing on the target with great precision for us at a very specific point on the missile tank. So it's done through a transition of going from a passive infrared sensor to a illuminator tracking laser that gives you information required to do real-time atmospheric compensation. And then the high-energy laser goes out at the conjugate, actually the conjugate of the atmospheric distortion between you and the target, and you end up destroying the target.
How about a number of jobs does this program create?
We will probably be hiring up to close to 1,000 people.
For this phase of the 1.1 billion?
For this phase of the program, yes. Yes.
Will NATO be invited to participate, get in on the ground floor of this, the way NATO has AWACS?
I guess.
I think that's not come up yet.
Yeah, I was going to say they haven't expressed interest yet. If they do, we'll deal with that when they.
We're a ways off, but we'll yeah.
The other team is led by Rockwell, Hughes, and E-Systems. With their prime subcontractors.
Let's get one over here. One, two.
Yes, sir.
A couple questions. One is, do you know the crew size yet for the plane?
Yes. Right now we're sizing it at a crew of 6, 2 up front, 4 in the back. The idea being to keep the crew size minimal, and everything happens so quickly in boost phase. A lot of the functions are totally automated.
And for the plane to even know to look for the plume coming out of the clouds, I assumed it's steered by an IR satellite or a missile warning satellite.
No, there are infrared sensors on the aircraft. They are looking 360 degrees around, so no matter which way the airplane is flying or pointing, you'll be able to pick up that missile plume as it breaks through this cloud deck here. So you're searching constantly 360 degrees around you, looking for that missile plume. And you can pick it up at ranges greater than the lethal range of the laser itself.
So if the sensors on the plane cannot see the, if the missile is too far for the sensors on the plane, it's too far for the plane to
kill it.
Right. How many times can the weapon fire without being refueled or re-energized? How do you do that?
If you recall, I mentioned to you that the dwell time is nominally 5 seconds. Sometimes it's less, sometimes it's longer. The chemical farm on the airplane is sized to provide roughly a capability for about 30 engagements. Yes, sir.
You talked about having 3 aircraft to maintain a 24-hour orbit. How will they be deployed, like one at a time, cycling through, 2 with 1 cycling? What will be the deployment approach?
Of course, the concept will be to keep the orbit, occupied at all times with an airborne laser. So one will stay on orbit until it actually gets its relief on orbit. This is very similar to how we employ AWACS today, joint stars.
So one aircraft would be standard deployed. Okay.
Yes, sir.
You're not going to. Sorry.
Well, let me take her. Yes, sir.
It's a pretty high-value asset itself. Do you anticipate doing anything more than just studying any possibilities for self-protection in this space, for instance, putting fighters to protect it when it's up?
Yeah, well, of course, you know, the baseline aircraft will have the standard suite of self-protection capabilities to include chaff, flares, et cetera. One of the things that we're going to be continuing to study as the design evolves is the self-protection suite that is most cost-effective for the aircraft. But there is an inherent self-protection capability, so that influences us somewhat as to what that suite will eventually be. But there's more work to be done in that area.
So you haven't decided whether you'd sort of allocate fighters to protect it?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Of course, airborne laser will, you'll have to have air superiority to protect this. It will be a high-value airborne asset, as is Joint Stars, AWACS, and so it will be relying on the ability of the Joint Forces Commander to control the airspace and to keep fighters away from it, et cetera. But, of course, as you might imagine, it'll have a good capability to just retrograde if there's a fighter threat, but we plan to have it supported like we do Joint Stars, AWACS, et cetera. But should something get through that defense, then it will have a capability to defend itself. I think what's important here is to understand that that takes away, if it has to protect itself, takes away from its primary mission of killing ballistic missiles, should they be launched.
I know it's going to depend on what the threat missile is, but what is the, and this may be classified, but can you give an unclassified range of time between bursting through the clouds and when you need to get it?
Well, that's kind of what this is, I think. 40 to 100 seconds from the time you can see it, let's say at 39,000 feet, to the time it burns out. Once it burns out, you can't get it any longer because you can't see it. So basically, on some of the shorter range missiles, you may have as little as 40 seconds to do.
To subtract the 40 seconds between launch and...
Let me try it this way. The shorter range missiles, the shortest range missiles are boosting 40 seconds just to get through the cloud deck, and then they boost another 40 seconds before they stop boosting in total. The longest range missiles are boosting 40 seconds to get through the clouds, plus another 100 seconds.
So this is sort of like a window here between breaking through the clouds and burnout is kind of your window that you've got to get this thing, and you've got between 40 and 100 seconds, depending on what kind of missile you're talking about. Okay, back over here.
Yeah. Maybe it'll field for basically 10 years. Now, you're relying here on the pressurized boosters. Are you sure that in, you know, 2006, the predominance of the threat is still going to be those types of ballistic missiles, and that they're not going to change, and then you'll have an obsolete or useless system?
Either way.
We have roughly 30 missiles on our threat list. I won't say what they are, but they extend out from existing missiles to ones that are projected out for the time frame that we're talking about. We've had that validated by the appropriate intelligence communities, and we are designing to meet to kill the hard